Hello, hello, another year, which means another Oscars, and I am back with another Oscar video. And if predicting Best Picture under the preferential ballot wasn't hard enough, let's throw in a worldwide pandemic in the mix to make it even that much more unpredictable. Now, for those who don't know me, my name is Ryan, and for the last few years, I've been conducting different experiments to find a way to crack the code on who will win Best Picture. So the first two videos I did were experiments involving the preferential ballot system. So if you haven't seen those videos and want to understand how the preferential ballot system works, I definitely recommend checking them out. Though it was fun to conduct and very, very close, the experiments were not incredibly successful on giving us our winner. So last year, I decided to change it up and try to predict Best Picture using a handful of the most staggering Oscar stats I can find. And would you know it, the experiment finally panned out. Okay, so the winner today was Parasite, that won with 8 votes. Now, that could just be dumb random luck, or perhaps we could be onto something. So this year, we're gonna go for it again. We're gonna be using the same Oscar stats we used last year to see which Best Picture nominee has the least hurdles to jump. And I know I'm kind of speaking to the choir here, but some of you may be wondering, what the heck are Oscar stats and why do they matter? For those who don't know, Oscar stats is basically looking at previous winners and finding familiar patterns that led to their success. So many times these stats are based on a variety of industry awards that lead up to Oscar night. We call those precursor awards. Awards like DGA, Directors Guild of America, Producers Guild of America, and Screen Actors Guild Awards are a few examples of the industry awards that very often pick the same winner the Academy ends up choosing as well. The challenging thing about Oscar stats is that they're constantly being broken, and Oscar stats are not foolproof, which makes predicting very difficult because we're unsure which Oscar stat to trust and which not to. So that got me thinking, what if instead of relying heavily on one or two specific Oscar stats, let's consider all of them. Let's put them in a big pile here, stack them up, make a stat stack, and let's consider all of these and see which Best Picture nominee has the most stats working in its favor. So like every year, I have every Best Picture nominee here, and for each one of these stats the Best Picture nominee applies to, I'm gonna award it 1 point. And the film with the most stats in its favor, with the most points at the end, will be my prediction for Best Picture. So let's just jump right in. Now, before I get started, I wanna quickly explain two rules I set for this that I also explained last year. Rule number one, I only use stats that go back to 2009. Since that's when the Oscars started implementing this preferential ballot system again, and being how that system has given us some really unpredictable winners, I decided to only use data from 2009 and above. And rule number two, the stat needed to have at least an 80% accuracy rating or more. Anything lower I deemed to be way too inconsistent for the study. I wanna go with only the best of the best stats. So for example, one stat last year was an 80% effective rating. However, I had to throw that stat out based on Parasite actually breaking that stat, and it dropped its percentage below the 80% threshold. So I just wanted to mention that. Other than that, let's just jump right in. And if you're confused, don't worry. I'm gonna show you as I move along. All right, so let's go ahead and get started. I have my first staggering stat right here. This one I call the SAG Ensemble Nomination Stat. And this one says since 2009, 9 out of the last 11 Best Picture winners have had a SAG, a Screen Actors Guild Ensemble nomination. And there's only 2 films this year that had those SAG ensembles, and that was Trial of Chicago 7 and Minari. Okay, moving on to our next stat. We have the DGA nomination stat. This stat says since 2009, 11 out of the last 11 Best Picture winners were also nominated for DGA. So this year, only 5 films here were nominated for DGA, and that was Trial of Chicago 7, Promising Young Woman, Nomadland, Mank, and Minari. All right, moving on to our next stat. This one says the editing nomination stat, and this one says since 2009, 10 out of the last 11 Best Picture winners also received an editing nomination. So there's only five films here that also have a editing nomination, and that is The Trial of Chicago 7, Promising Young Woman, Nomadland, Sound of Metal, and The Father. Moving on to our next stat. We have the Golden Globe Screenplay nomination stat, and this one says since 2009, 11 out of the last 11 Best Picture winners have received a screenplay nomination for the Golden Globes. And there's only five films here that received a Golden Globe screenplay nomination, and that is The Trial of Chicago 7, Promising Young Woman, Nomadland, Mank, and The Father. Okay, moving on to our next stat. This one is the Any Acting Nomination stat. This one says since 2009, 10 out of the last 11 Best Picture winners had also have at least one acting nomination. So this year was an interesting year in which every single Best Picture nominee this year does have an acting nomination. So every single film gets a point this year. So we're gonna give a point to Sound of Metal, point to The Father, Nomadland, Promising Young Woman, Trial of Chicago 7, Judas and the Black Messiah, Minari, and Mank. Great year for acting. There's actually been only one winner since 2009 that did not have an acting nomination that managed to win Best Picture, and that was very recently, that was Parasite. And there's actually been four times though since 1995. Moving on to our next stat, we have the Best Director nomination stat. This one says since 2009, 9 out of the last 11 Best Picture winners have also received a Best Director nomination. Okay, there's been two outliers. That was Argo and Green Book, who did not have a Best Director nomination but still went on to win Best Picture since 2009. This year we have four of them. We have Promising Young Woman, Nomadland, Mank, and Minari. All right, this next stat is called the Golden Globe Director Nomination Stat. This one says since 2009, every single Best Picture winner has received a Golden Globe nomination for director. And this year only four films fit that quota, and that is The Trial of Chicago 7, Promising Young Woman, Nomadland, and Mank. Okay. Moving on to our next one. This one is the Major Guild Win stat. This one says since 2009, 10 out of the last 11 Best Picture winners have won at least a DGA, a PGA, or a SAG. This year, only two films managed to pull off a DGA, PGA, or SAG, and that was Nomadland and Trial of Chicago 7. So they both get a point. All right, moving on to our next stat. This one is called the Major Award Show Win stat. This one says since 2009, 10 out of the last 11 Best Picture winners have won at least BAFTA, Critics' Choice, or Golden Globe for Best Film. There's only been one time this has happened since 2009 where they didn't have any of those, and that was Moonlight. This year, only one film managed to pull off a BAFTA, Critics' Choice, and Golden Globe, and that was Nomadland. Okay, we're down to our last stat. Just to recap the score really quick, we have Nomadland in the lead with 8 points. We have Trial of Chicago 7 with 7 points, and Promising Young Woman with 6. The rest of the film's following behind, so it's gonna come down to this question right here. This is called the Telluride Film Festival stat. This is one of my favorite quirky little stats. This one says since 2009, 9 out of the last 11 Best Picture winners played at the Telluride Film Festival. So there's only been two films since 2009 that did not play at Telluride that went on to win Best Picture, and that was Green Book and Hurt Locker. There's only been two films this year that were set to screen at Telluride, so this is where it gets interesting, because technically there actually wasn't a Telluride Film Festival this year due to COVID, but they did release what would have originally been slated to play at Telluride, and that was Nomadland and The Father. But since the film festival didn't screen, I'm kind of in a pickle of not knowing what to do. I feel like we're gonna go ahead and give them a point, but just know that it's questionable. either way, we have a clear winner. We have Nomadland winning with 9 points. And then we have Trial of Chicago 7 coming in second place with 7 points. Promising Young Woman in third with 6. And then we have Mank over here with 5. Minari with 4 points here. The Father with 4 points as well. Then we have Sound of Metal with 2. And Judas and the Black Messiah with 1. So what does this little experiment show us? It shows us that based on these stats, that Nomadland currently has the least amount of hurdles to win Best Picture. Currently, Nomadland does not have that SAG nomination, which is why it doesn't have 10 points, but it pretty much appears to have everything else it needs to win. And it's pretty representative, if you look at this right now, of what professionals are predicting as well. A lot of professionals are picking Nomadland to win, and these two as kind of the second place, third place choices. If I was going purely based off my own gut, not even looking at stats, I might have gone with Trial of Chicago 7. It just feels like something that they typically would go for, though it is missing that Best Director nomination. But Green Book recently won, and they didn't have a director nomination. Unlike Green Book, though, that did win PGA, Trial of Chicago did win SAG, which could echo maybe a year like Spotlight, when Spotlight won SAG, it won maybe one or two other awards, so who knows. But that being said, I'm sticking with this experiment. I'm predicting Nomadland to win Best Picture. Now, warning, okay? I wouldn't place massive Vegas bets on this study alone, because this is not backed by any real science. I can't back this up with any real certainty at all. And as mentioned in the last video though, I did play out this experiment with previous years, and it was surprisingly accurate. Every single year, the film with the most points did end up taking on Best Picture, with exception of 2 years. One of those years was a tie between Moonlight and La La Land with 10 points each. Another year, Roma beat out Green Book by 1 point, though we know what actually really happened. But you know what? Let me go ahead and actually just show you what those years looked like using this same formula. Pretty interesting, right? What do you guys think? Am I potentially onto something, or did I just fall victim to the Oscar rabbit hole once again? Let me know in the comments below. Also, I would like to mention that if this Oscar stuff kind of interests you, I'd really recommend people like Sasha Stone at Awards Daily, or people at Gold Derby, or all these different sites. I'll leave some links in the little description below, so that way you can check out those people. Other than that, I want to hear from you guys. Let me know which film you're predicting for Best Picture this year. Let me know if there's any Oscar stats that are staggering that I should consider. But again, I really appreciate you guys watching this video, and I'll see you guys next time.